In this screencast, we will go through some fluid kinematics calculations to determine the following characteristics for a fluid flow field. We're going to determine the volumetric dilatation rate, the rotation vector, and the angular deformation for the following 3D flow field. So you're given three different velocities in a Cartesian system: the velocity in the x direction, the velocity in the y direction, and the velocity in the z direction. Let's start with the volumetric dilatation rate. This is basically the change in volume per unit volume. Or in other words, it gives us an idea of whether the fluid is incompressible, since a fluid element cannot change volume without a change in fluid density. So to determine this, we look at the linear deformation in all three directions. So the change in the velocity in the x direction with respect to x, plus the change in the velocity in the y direction with respect to y, as well as that in the z direction with respect to z. This could also be rewritten in this form, where we have the gradient operator dot product with the velocity vector. So this may look kind of familiar. This pops out of the continuity equation in the differential form when we have a steady state flow field as well as an incompressible fluid. We state that this is equal to zero. However, we don't know that here, so we just want to determine whether it is equal to zero or not. So to proceed, we take the derivative of the velocity in the x direction with respect to x. So du dx is equal to 2xy dv dy is equal to 0. And lastly, dw dz is equal to 2z. So this means our volumetric dilatation rate is equal to 2xy plus 2z, which shows us that this is not equal to zero, and therefore it is not an incompressible fluid. So next we're going to look at the rotation vector. So let's first look at the rotation around the z-axis. So to do this, we take the average of the angular velocities, which in this case is the difference between dv dx and du dy. So again, we go back to our velocity equations. We take the derivative of the y velocity with respect to x. Then we subtract out the partial derivative of the x velocity, u, with respect to y. This gives us the rotation around z equal to negative 2z minus 1/2 x squared. So we repeat this for around the x-axis, omega x. We get 1/2 partial of w with respect to y minus the partial of v with respect to z. This gives us the rotation around the x-axis equal to 3/2 x plus y plus 1/2 z. Lastly, the rotation around the y-axis, 1/2 du dz minus dw dx. So again, taking the partials, we get the following. So since we're looking for the rotation vector, now we just take the individual components and put it into our vector form. And so now we've found our rotation vector. The last part of the problem was to determine the angular deformation. The thing is that we could have fluid rotation around an axis that causes no angular deformation, such as that imagine spinning around an axis but the shape is maintained, whereas angular deformation means that the two different angular rotations don't cancel each other, and therefore our shape or our volume does deform. So let's say we're just looking in one plane, the xy plane, and we want to know if there's any angular deformation around the z-axis. So we take the partial of the x velocity with respect to y, add the partial of the y velocity with respect to x. And when we take a look at this, again, we've already done these before, and we see that our angular deformation is equal to x squared minus 2z, which is not equal to zero. So therefore, we do have an angular deformation of the fluid. So hopefully this gives you an idea on how to do these fluid kinematics calculations given velocities of our fluid field. Since a lot of these types of calculations use the same partial derivatives, you could take these at the beginning and place them in a table so you could just pick and plug into the equations later, but it's all personal preference.